Good evening to one and all. High Nine welcomes everybody in this hall and also all our online viewers who are watching this event live. High Nine deeply appreciates your effort to join us today and offer you our most grateful welcome to the third event on High Nine Talks. Before starting this event, let me take this opportunity to introduce the intention behind conducting High Nine Talks. Let us grow through some statistics about internet and digital health. In the next 2 years, we are going to find more than 500 million internet users in India. And thanks to our Modi government for this Digital India initiative to connect people even from rural areas. Recent survey by Via Media on digital health content and communication says that in near future, 49% of internet users will be using digital media for healthcare information. So High Nine took this opportunity to conduct High Nine Talks for connecting people and doctors through this digital platform. Any query regarding a medical topic of discussion will be answered by our expert panel through this platform. We will build a library of answers to the questions that people generally have in their mind, which will be accessible to all. Videos on the website cover topics on different diseases, surgeries, and the cost details. All these videos are also available on High9.tv. I will start this event with a Sanskrit saying, Sarvindranyam Nayanam Pradhanam, meaning of all the sense organs, eyes are the most valuable. Once again, High Nine welcomes you all to the most awaited event, High Nine Talks on Ophthalmology. Thank you so much, Doctor.
Amongst you all. Between all of us, our endeavor would be to clarify the doubts that you may have vis-a-vis the eye care, as well as give you an idea about the various eye conditions that we commonly come across. In the last few years, there has been a tremendous progress in the field of the eye care. The diagnostic and the treatment capabilities have improved greatly. The conditions that were untreatable and blinding are no more so. With continuing research in the instrumentation, technology, and surgical methodology, future is bright for the eye care. Stem cell research is a field which is very promising and holds promise for being able to treat some very intractable conditions. There definitely are many, many situations where we find ourselves totally helpless in restoring the vision. However, with improving low vision aids and improved rehabilitation techniques, there is a lot of hope for visually handicapped people. I will now go to some of the common conditions that we see as far as the eyes are concerned and give you an overview of what these conditions are like and what we can or we cannot do as far as these situations are concerned. One of the most common conditions that we come across is a cataract. Cataract usually occurs in the older age group, but can occur in any age group starting from birth to, like I said, the old age. Now, some people would ask me a question, would I get the cataract? My answer is that if you live long enough. Now, what is long enough? Each individual situation will be different. There will be an individual who will go up to 100 years and will develop a cataract at the age of 100 years. There'll be another person who may develop it much before that. Cataract surgery has undergone tremendous changes in the last four decades. From the time when the cataract was operated only when it became mature to the present time when it is removed as and when the individual has visual problems which are ascribable to the cataract. The earlier methods involved removing the lens as a whole and prescribing thick soda water bottle glasses, which caused a lot of disturbances in the vision. Surgery was a very involved procedure requiring large cut and multiple stitches, which caused a lot of discomfort to the patient. In the last four decades, with the introduction of the IOL, the visual outcome has improved remarkably. The earlier method was extracapsular cataract extraction, along with the implantation of an IOL. This required a large cut and multiple stitches. In cataract surgery, the lens inside the eye becomes cloudy, which is removed and replaced with another, which is what is called as a IOL or intraocular lens. Most cataracts, as I said earlier, are due to the aging. At times it may be congenital, an injury may cause a cataract, drugs like steroids, radiation can also result into cataract formation. In the past several decades, the cataract surgery has undergone rapid development in terms of techniques, the calculation of the power, the type of IOLs implanted, which has resulted in tremendously better visual outcomes. A remarkable change happened after the introduction of phacoemulsification, where ultrasonic energy is used to break the lens into small fragments through a small keyhole. Nowadays, as small as 1.4 millimeters, to remove the cataractous lens, followed by implantation of a foldable IOL. This technique has become the gold standard for modern cataract surgery, as it has minimal complications. Unlike in the previous methods, there is no need for injections and sutures. One can attend to his or her routine without any restrictions, such as reading, driving, using computers, etc., from next day onwards. Almost no restrictions are imposed on the routine activity. Results are excellent, and vision improves to normal with no distortion. The latest and the most innovative method in today's era is the femtosecond laser, which has revolutionized the cataract surgery. This is an image-guided technology where the key steps of the phacoemulsification are done by this laser, making the entire procedure safer, more predictable, and precise. The laser method is very useful in difficult and challenging cataracts, particularly congenital cataracts or the cataract which a child develops, where it is difficult to otherwise do what is called as a capsular excess, and it makes it easy for the surgeon as well as patient. As far as the intraocular lenses are concerned, the recent advances in IOL technology have changed the outlook of the cataract surgery. An intraocular lens mimicking the original lens is certainly a challenge, but many manufacturers are able to produce such a good quality IOL. There is a myth in some people that glasses may not be necessary after this. But if you are implanting a monofocal IOL, the glasses will necessarily be required, at least for reading, if not for distance. But if a multifocal or an accommodative IOL is implanted, one may do away with the glasses. Cataract, once operated, never recurs. What can sometimes happen is that vision becomes blurry due to opacification of posterior capsule, which can easily be handled by using a laser to cut the capsule. I will now come to what is becoming more and more common, particularly for the younger individuals, and that is what is called as a LASIK or a refractive surgery. Refractive surgery actually encompasses a lot of things that can be done to the eye, but the two most common operations or the surgeries that we do for refractive correction is LASIK and what is called as a ICL, or an implantation of a lens inside the eye. Laser vision correction today, which is properly known as LASIK, has been revolutionized over the past few years. Dramatic advances happened to produce excellent visual results. New treatment modalities like customized LASIK, blade-free, or femtosecond laser have been developed, where one can be sure of excellent outcome without any complications. Nevertheless, it is a mistake to think that technology alone is responsible for the good results that we get. The skill, experience, and judgment of the surgeon is as important as technology. A screening test has to be done for every patient prior to scheduling him or her for LASIK surgery to decide about the suitability of the procedure. In some people, when LASIK surgery is not possible, another surgical option is available, which is known as implantable contact lens, or ICL. It is implanted in the eye through a small keyhole incision. This will remain in the eye permanently. It is safe,
made of highly biocompatible material. These procedures are very helpful for people who want to enhance their looks and personality, and also in certain jobs like defense services, pilots, etc. Some of the corneal conditions which I would like to refer to. A cornea is the round black structure in the eye. It is actually not black or brown, but is completely transparent. The color is due to a structure behind called as iris. And in black people or in brown people like us, it is usually the cornea usually looks brown or black, but in whites or the Caucasians, it looks much lighter. That is because the pigment in the iris in those people is much less than what we people have. According to the WHO, the corneal diseases are the major cause of vision loss and blindness in the world today, after cataract and glaucoma. In India, it is estimated that approximately 6.8 million people have vision which is less than 660 in at least one eye due to corneal disease. Of these, about 1 million have bilateral involvement. Corneal ulceration is a significant cause of corneal blindness. In India, approximately 1.5 to 2 million people develop corneal ulcer annually. The spectrum of microbial keratitis varies with geographical location. It is reported more in rural population, particularly in those belonging to lower socioeconomic strata. Trauma is often the most significant precipitating factor for the development of the infective keratitis. Some of the common traditional eye medicines used, such as breast milk, saliva, is also an important risk factor. It is interesting to see that even the highly educated people I've come across who would use or advocate the use of the breast milk for the treatment of some of these corneal conditions, which, as I said, could be counterproductive and could actually cause more problems. The eye donation scene in India is very grim. On an average, the country needs 2 lakh corneas in a year as against the collection of only 44,000. Out of this, only 46% is utilized for sight restoration, as the other 54% do not meet the standards for transplantation. Femtosecond laser has also been used to increase the chances of survival of the graft and better visual outcome after the transplant. The cutting of the tissues with the help of the femtosecond laser is fine, thereby reducing the post-operative astigmatism, thereby giving a superior visual outcome. Loss of vision in children due to corneal problems is of particular concern, because if these children are treated early, visual outcome may be significantly better. Coming on to a condition called as a glaucoma. Glaucoma is the second major cause of blindness after cataract, with an estimated more than 60 million cases worldwide, which is likely to increase to 80 million by 2020. In India, glaucoma affects around 12 million people, that is one-fifth of global glaucoma burden, and is responsible for 12.3% of total blindness in the country. The estimated prevalence of glaucoma is 2.65% in people above 40 years of age. The rate of undiagnosed glaucoma cases in India is 90%, in contrast to 40 to 60% in the developed world. Most of these patients present either visually disabled or permanently blind from the disease. Glaucoma awareness in both rural and urban communities is poor. Glaucoma is a group of diseases characterized by progressive damage to the optic nerve, causing gradual, irreversible vision loss, ultimately leading to blindness. There are two types of glaucomas mainly, the closed angle and the open angle glaucoma. In the more common open angle type, the slow buildup of the eye pressure causes gradual optic nerve damage, manifesting in the progressive loss of side vision. Over time, the central vision may get wiped out too. The less common closed angle type may present with sudden rise in eye pressure, causing headache, decreased vision, redness, and rainbow halos around lights. So open angle glaucoma comes like a thief without you really becoming aware of the fact that you are having a glaucoma. On the other hand, the closed angle glaucoma comes like an armed robber and lets you know that, look, I'm here, take care of me. Glaucoma can affect any age group, including newborn infants, children, and elderly. Factors which increase the risk of having glaucoma are high intraocular pressure, older age group, race, Africans and Hispanics have higher incidence of open angle glaucoma. Asians have more closed angle type. Positive family history, systemic diseases like diabetes, hypertension, long-term use of steroid medications, myopia, eyeball injuries, etc. Though the blindness caused by glaucoma is irreversible, timely detection and management is the key to save the vision. Anyone having the above mentioned risk factors should undergo a comprehensive eye checkup to detect glaucoma. Since raised intraocular pressure is the only modifiable risk factor, glaucoma treatment aims to reduce eye pressure by reducing fluid production by drugs and/or improving the fluid drainage out of the eye by means of laser and surgery. Recently, a new modality of glaucoma treatment has been introduced, but in this country that is called as a HIFU, or what is high intensity focused ultrasound, which takes care of some of these intractable situations and reduces the need for glaucoma medication. Coming on to the sensitive layer in the eye, which is called as the retina, the common conditions that one come across as far as the retina is concerned, diabetic retinopathy, it is a manifestation of long-standing diabetes. It will affect 80% of all patients who have had diabetes for 20 years or more. The longer a person has diabetes, higher are his chances of developing a retinopathy. Diabetic retinopathy, unfortunately, produces almost no symptoms. However, in the advanced stages, it can produce blurred vision, distortion of images, or black dots or floaters. The management of the condition is by either giving laser, injection of corticosteroids or anti-VEGF agents into the eye. Sometimes when there is a vitreous hemorrhage or the hemorrhage inside the eye, it may require a surgical intervention. Hypertensive retinopathy is caused by a consistently high blood pressure, and it can result in damage to the arterial and the arteriolar circulation in response to the high blood pressure. Myopia is a refractive error, as a matter of fact. However, it affects the retina in the sense that the high myopes, particularly the ones who have myopia more than 6 diopters, may have weakness in the retina, which is called as a lattice degeneration, and which can, if not taken care of, lead to retinal detachment. And also the myopes are more prone to develop open-angle glaucoma that I referred to earlier. If one detects lattice degeneration, it is important to take care of this degeneration by using laser prophylactically so that it doesn't lead to the retinal detachment. Because once the retinal detachment occurs, the surgery becomes more complicated and more involved. If the retinal detachment does occur, it gives rise to flashes of light. Patient may complain of increased number of floaters, and there may be floaters in the central vision or the temporal vision. Sometimes a dense shadow may be seen because of the detachment of the retina. The impression that a veil or a curtain has drawn over the field of vision. Straight lines may become crooked in the event of an appearance of sudden flashes of light or floaters. An eye doctor must be consulted lest it is a condition of retinal detachment, which must be taken care of as early as possible. The treatment basically involves surgical intervention. Various types of surgeries are done. The retinal surgeon will decide on that. Some of the conditions that I would like to refer to, particularly in children, one of the commonest problems that the pediatric ophthalmologist faces is the condition of what is called as a squint. I'm told in this part of the country, the crossed eye is supposed to be lucky for the family. I don't really know whether it really is. It can affect the psychological makeup of the child starting from early years in school. Child may get ridiculed in college and have poor job prospects due to poor eye contact. Try finding a match for a person with squint. You will know what it really entails. It can be devastating in many respects. squint causes loss of vision in the squinting eye if not corrected before 8 years of age, so it is beyond looks. Squint does not get corrected with age. The visual loss happens fast. It is extremely important to correct this as soon as possible. Delaying does no good. It in fact causes more problems, particularly leading to a lazy eye, which may not be correctable. The other important condition that one sees in children is refractive errors, which may be recognized if a child squeezes the eyes, squints, or turns his or her head to one side, rubs the eyes too often. If not corrected, it may cause a lazy eye and may require long treatment to correct. It is therefore important for the parents to consult a doctor if the child shows any of these symptoms. A white reflex, if seen when one sees the black part of the eye, may be due to a cataract or a retinal disorder, or could also be as serious a condition as an eye cancer. Constant watering from a child's eye may be a sign of blocked eye duct. Beyond 1 year of age, massage does not help, and minor surgery may be needed to open the passage. If a child looks at objects with a head turn, it may be due to eye muscles not acting or eyes shaking, called as nystagmus. Vision and head turn can be corrected with glasses or surgery. The last thing that I want to cover is cosmetic surgery as related to the eye. Eyes not only make one see the world, but also are organs through which the world sees you. Beautiful eyes, well-placed, attract everyone. There are many situations when this appearance is disturbed. Some of these conditions may be congenital and some others develop later in life. Some of these may be due to various types of injuries or various diseases of the body. Many of these conditions may also lead to visual loss. Clearly, these need to be taken care of for both cosmetic and visual reasons. In the last few decades, cosmetic surgery for and around the eyes has become extremely important and popular. Who is there who would not like to look beautiful? The ophthalmic plastic surgeon can make one's eyes look pretty. There are various modalities to do so in their armamentarium, surgery to Botox injections. Remember, a drooping eyelid or a damaged lid, protruding or puffy eyes can have a devastating effect on the psychological makeup of an individual, leading to lack of confidence and an inferiority complex. Sometimes we forget the appearance is very important or equally important for the development of the one's personality as the vision of the individual is. I would rest my talk at this stage, and I along with my fellow panelists will be happy to answer any of your queries and questions. Thank you very much.
Doctor, for such an insightful speech on the different kinds of surgical methods available for cataract and the different conditions and different problems related to eyes. And we are also happy to know a few good to know informations like breast milk is not a alternate medicine to treat any of the conditions as suggested by few. And we are also happy to know that the technology has developed drastically, and we have treatments like IOL, femtosecond laser technology, and etc. I would like to brief once again all the panel members of us today's talk show. Dr. Sri Lakshmi Nimbagada Garu, Dr. Nilanjana Dev Jardar, Dr. Jyosna Mayaneni, Dr. Shubhra Goel Garu, and Dr. Satish Gupta Garu. Now, I would like first to invite Dr. Sri Lakshmi Nimbagada Garu onto the stage and grace her chair. Next, I would like to invite Dr. Nilanjana Dev Jardar Garu onto the stage and grace her chair. I request Mr. Shiva Garu to hand over the plan to Dr. Jyotsna Garu. And Shiva Garu, please hand over the plan to Dr. Shubhra Garu. And finally, once again, I invite Dr. Satish Gupta Garu onto the stage and grace your chair. For the core of the event, the questionnaire round, though Dr. Satish Garu has answered most of our questions, but yet our audience would be like to know much more in detail. Yeah, today's first question for this evening to Dr. Jyotsna Garu. What tests are required to identify vision problems in children? in children, basically diffraction is the most important thing. And once and again, it depends upon the age of the child. The child is too young to identify the letters or alphabets. They have the special test called Teller Activity Charts and all. And these are not available everywhere, and they are available with the pediatric ophthalmologist and screen specialist usually. And refraction is a basic test, or we can do retinoscopy for very young young children and babies, and also we can do the retinal examination as well.
Okay. Thank you so much, Doctor. Dr. Satish Karu, can herbal medicines cure cataract?
There is no cure for cataract by any medicine in the world, whether it is herbal, homeopathy, Ayurveda, or Yunani, or there are people who claim to take care of cataract by Reiki, ABCDFG. None of them is helpful. One can be absolutely 100% clear. The only treatment as of today is surgery. There is no medical treatment.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Sri Lakshmi Garu, what are the surgical options for treating cataract? Does patients have a choice to select the surgical type?
Yeah, now already Dr. Satish Gupta elaborated about the surgical options for cataract. As the gold standard is the phacoemulsification. It is done using ultrasonic energy. We enter the eye through a small keyhole and then break the nucleus into small pieces, and then it has been sucked out. It's like imagine an egg having a shell, and inside you see the, you know, you have that yellow and white. So just imagine opening is made part of the shell, and you scoop out that yellow and white. That remaining is filled with another lens. The surgery is all about that. It's very simple, see. But then, you know, the ultrasound is, for phacoemulsification is the gold standard, of course. But now we have another latest processor known as femtosecond laser. Here we don't use any blades to enter the eye. It's done with the laser, and those making that lens into fragments also is done by the laser. So by using this laser, we are gaining more, you know, the safety is more, the precision is more, and procedure is made much more easier and simple even for the patients as well.
Dr. Satish Karu, what are the short-term and long-term advantages to patients if they undergo bladeless cataract surgery?
The advantage, obviously, that is more precise, more predictable, and the results are likely to be much better. Because when we make an opening with the hand, there is no guarantee that you will get exactly the size that you want. We make an opening in what is called as a capsule. And if I want a 5 millimeter opening, I get 5 millimeter if I use the laser. But I can't guarantee that with my hand, however smart or good surgeon I may be. Similarly, when you are breaking, like Dr. Sri Lakshmi said, when you are breaking the lens into small pieces in order to suck it out, you have already done part of it by the use of the laser. So obviously, it makes it much easier for the surgeon to bring the things out. So for surgeon, it is good. And for the patient, clearly, it is good if the surgeon is good.
Dr. Jyotsna Garu, when should a patient with diabetes undergo eye test? Will they have any symptom to begin with?
Actually, it depends upon the type of the diabetes the patient has. If the patient has type 2 diabetes and he has to go for the eye test as soon as the diagnosis is being made. And if the patient has type 1 diabetes, he has to go for an eye examination after 5 years of the diagnosis of the disease.
Another question to you.
Yeah.
With increase in preterm deliveries, there is exponential increase in retinopathy of prematurity in preterm babies.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can you please provide your views on it?
Yeah. With the increase in the alarming increase in the newborn babies who are born preterm, and moreover increase in the facilities for the facilities for providing them good environment for the babies to survive, and there is alarmingly increasing in the rise of retinopathy of premature. Very few people are trained in screening the babies, and most in well-established hospitals in Hyderabad itself, the screening programs, in spite of doing, many babies are getting missed out for this screening. And in peripheries and all, there is a lot of deficiency in this. And actually treating a old patient more than 50 years with cataract and all, hardly will be serving for another 10, 15 years. But in a baby with, the screening is missed, and the baby will be blind for the rest of the life. So the retinal screening is the most important for any preterm baby, which is born before 32 weeks of gestation.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Dr. Nilanjana, how often should a person go for glaucoma check?
See, glaucoma check is not required for every individual. As sir has already mentioned, certain risk factors like having a family member with glaucoma or a person who's an elderly age group above 40, or there is some systemic risk factor like BP, sugar, or he has short sight like myopia. So, or he has used some medications like steroids, which can increase the eye pressure. So these are basically the risk factors. So if a person has these factors, then he should go for a regular eye examination, because glaucoma evaluation doesn't need any big facility or anything. Just a simple eye examination can pick up glaucoma, provided the person is looking for it. So once there is a suspicion of glaucoma, then further investigations can be advised, and things can go on from there.
Doctor, could you please brief us a little bit about what exactly is glaucoma? Though Dr. Satish Garu has already told, but we would like to listen from you.
Glaucoma is a group of diseases, like it's not a single entity. Initially, we were under the impression that always the eye with high pressure is called glaucomatous. But now the definition has been redefined. What we call it now is a group of diseases where the optic nerve basically undergoes damage. The increase in the eye pressure is just a risk factor. But then other factors also are there, like if the systemic risk factors like sugar, BP and there. So the blood circulation to the optic nerve is decompensated. So that can lead to optic nerve damage. So basically this is a condition which is totally silent, doesn't have any symptoms in the beginning, unless that's an angle closure type, where it can present suddenly with symptoms like headache or redness and eye pain. So in the most common type, it may be totally asymptomatic, and the person can gradually lose his sight vision over a long period of time. And at that point of time, when it is diagnosed, in many cases, it is usually reversible. So that's why the importance of screening and periodic evaluation. And there are a lot of people like who come for a checkup, they prescribe some drops, and they think that they are always like secure, and they keep on continuing the same drug for years together without visiting the physician again, which is not a, like completely like, you know, healthy for the eyes, because these drugs can become inefficient over a period of time. The glaucoma can progress beyond the stage at which it was diagnosed, and it may need additional medications, maybe surgery can also be required. So a periodic evaluation once every 4 months or 6 months, depending on the severity of the disease, is recommended.
Can migraine headaches be mistaken or mistaken as glaucoma, or it could be reversed? Like, as you've just mentioned, that glaucoma also has a symptom like headache. So
migraine headaches, the only way it can simulate glaucoma, because migraine is usually a headache involving half side of the head. So suppose the eye pressure is increasing in only one eye, it can have it can mimic migraine. Migraine can also be associated with bouts of vomiting, nausea. So these can also be the symptoms associated with angle closure glaucoma. So there may be some confounding factors. So a lot of people, they keep taking this paracetamol tablet, migraine treatment, going to the neurologist, and then the neurologist sees the optic nerve and then sends to us for a glaucoma checkup.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Dr. Shubhra Garu, what is oculoplasty? We haven't heard of it much.
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that question, because a lot of people are not aware what is oculoplasty. See, if you just break the whole word, it's ocular means eyes and plasty means plastic. So plasty means to mold, right? So you must have heard of plastic surgery of body, but you haven't heard of plastic surgeries of eyes. So what an oculoplasty surgeon or an ophthalmic plastic surgeon does is that we deal with all the conditions where any reconstructive or cosmetic procedure around the eyes is needed. So we deal with disorders of eyelids, eyelashes, the whole socket where, you know, you must have seen patients coming with or people having bulged eyes or sunken eyes, and also, you know, the cosmetic procedures like eyelid bags, dark circles, and so on and so forth. So this is in short what is oculoplasty all about. So it's a very, very niche and very, very specialized part of ophthalmology now.
Thank you so much, doctor. The next question is again to you. How is your profession different from dermatologists and plastic surgeons?
Yeah, again, a very relevant question, because see, if I ask you, you have dark circles, where would you first knock the door?
Of course, a dermatologist.
Exactly. So that's where the fault is, right? I mean, it's not that you don't need a dermatologist, but the dark circles is primarily a disorder where you have some structural changes below the eyes. You get the hollowness, right? So how we differ from dermatologists or general body plastic surgeons is that, as the name suggests, the plastic surgeon or a general plastic surgeon would be dealing with anything structural or cosmetic when it comes to the whole body except around the eyes. And similarly, a dermatologist or a skin specialist would be dealing with anything on the skin over the body, maybe around the eyes, but not exactly treating the disorders around the eyes. So this is what I wanted to convey, is that we as oculoplasty surgeons are different from dermatologists and plastic surgeons, because we are treating only the disorders which are around the eyes. It starts from your brow and ends at your cheek area. So this is our area of interest.
Thank you so much, doctor. Dr. Jyotsna Garu, what are the reasons for increasing vision problems in children in last few years? Though we know few, but if you could suggest anything else.
And I think increasing the usage of electronic gadgets is the most important culprit for increasing the usage of and restriction of the outdoor activities among children. All the time they're on the tabs, or mobile phones, and laptops. And parents are the big, I think, had to parents are the main reason behind that. And it's excessive near work. Although it is not proven very much scientifically, but I strongly believe that excess near work, I mean near activity, and less more, and schools are also not been equipped with good outdoor activities, and all the time outdoor activities is very much restricted in even in cities like Hyderabad, and so, and this is what is there is alarmingly increasing in number of usage of glasses in very young children at starting from the age of 5 years.
So I think this is a point to be noted by all of us, that physical activity, lack of physical activity can also cause, you know, impaired vision. Thank you, doctor. Dr. Sri Lakshmi Garu, what are the reasons for blurred vision even after cataract surgery?
Just not the, may not be the cataract, like some maybe associated problems like glaucoma, or, you know, diabetic retinopathy, some other things we have to rule out first. And at times, after the cataract removal, we leave a capsule behind to place this artificial lens on top of it. So at times, this capsule also will develop a thin membrane kind of thing. So this will give rise to this blurred vision. But this can be handled very easily, because it's so difficult. The research has failed not to develop cataract, you know. All of us will end up cataract sometime or the other. But the technology is so good that, you know, cataracts can be handled so easily nowadays. Similarly, this membrane thing also, research again has failed to stop that. But there is a very easy way of, you know, handling it. This is called AG laser capsulotomy. It takes half a minute of the time. That's it. But as I said, you have to look into the other things also, just not the cataract. But cataract is reversible, of course. But Dr. Neelanjana's problem, glaucoma, is never a reversible phenomenon. And they always insist that you can forget your diet, but not the drops.
Thank you, doctor. Dr. Shubhra Garu, what are the side effects of using cosmetics in your eye? Mm-hmm. I mean, you'll see most of the people are using that.
Yeah, I wouldn't say there are any side effects if you choose your products well. Now, there are two reasons why you can have anything related to cosmetics is, number one, you don't know how to use them, how much is the quantity to be put, and what brand are you using. It's always advisable to go for good tested brands. And some of the individuals can develop allergies to these products, which can lead to redness, watering, irritation. We have tear glands around our eyelashes, which produces the tear film. These can get infected or blocked, and then you can have skin allergies. And secondly, what I've seen, especially with the younger generation or the IT, so-called IT sector, is that people have become very careless. You know, they'll put the makeup early in the morning because obviously everybody wants to look attractive and nice. And especially they have tired eyes and they want to cover it well, which is fine. But then it's equally important to clean it up at night. Take care of, you know, the basic care of cleaning and rinsing it off as you do for your teeth or for your feet or body. It is very important to clean, maintain the hygiene around the eyes. So that's what I would say. So choose your product well, apply it in optimum conditions, and hygiene is the key. And if you have any symptom, you should report to the nearest ophthalmologist as early as possible.
Dermatologist?
Okay. May I just add something to what Subhra said? Even now, a large number of people, particularly in the rural areas, even in the cities, for example, will be using their own fingers. The mothers will be using their own fingers to apply kajal, or, you know, to the children. And quite often, they're not cleaning their hands, and they're using the fingers, which are less than clean, to use that, and that can cause problems. As also sometimes they use the same finger and the same kajal from one child to the other child. The first child has some problem, this can be transferred to the other child. So in addition to what he was saying, which is absolutely right, I think it is also important to be aware of the hygiene with which the these things are applied. And also I am aware of the fact, I had it myself when I was a child, that sometimes you use this soot which is collected from the burning lamp. Perhaps no harm done, but again, it has to be something which is clean and hygienic. Otherwise, it can cause problems.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Sri Lakshmi Garu, do we need to wear glasses after cataract surgery?
There are varieties of intraocular lenses available. So, most commonly used is the monofocal IOL. So you have to wear glasses, okay, and then there are variety of IOLs to correct that. It's called, if there is any curvature defect, we implant toric IOLs that corrects your distance vision, but again, you have to wear reading glasses. So then, you know, people, like most of us, like to get away from glasses, so research has found that multifocal technology. So multifocal IOL technology, you don't have to wear glasses after your procedure. And there are variety of manufacturers have been, you know, coming out with good technology IOLs. So there is an option of, you know, getting away from glasses after the procedure.
Dr. Satish Garu, what are the side effects of cataract surgery and how can we avoid it?
Well, I won't use the word side effect, actually. There is really no side effect. However, complications could be there. So the complication could occur during the surgery. Complications can sometimes occur after the surgery. One has done a totally uneventful surgery, but the patient may still develop problems. Problems could be that of what we call as an infection, which is the most devastating thing that can occur to any individual as far as the eye is concerned. And if not taken care of properly, and even when it's taken care of properly, in some cases, one may lose the eye. The other problem could be that there could be what is called as the inflammation, which is different from infection, which can occur and can be controlled, but can also occur repeatedly. So there are some of these complications that are there, and of course, various other complications, like one may develop what is called as the edema of the cornea, etc., etc. I don't want to go into too many of them, otherwise nobody will get surgery done. So I don't want to recount all of them, but there could be a legion of complications. But the rate of complications is rather small.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Nilanjana, as already discussed, is glaucoma curable?
See, glaucoma is something like, to give you a simple example, it's something like diabetes. As long as you take your medicines, it's under control. The day you leave your medicines, it's out of control. So the treatment, the control is in your hands.
Another
question.
You
cannot get rid of glaucoma, but you can keep it under control.
Continuing the same question, can glaucoma be treated without medicines? Like, kindly brief us about HIFU technology.
See, the most easy treatment type in glaucoma is eye drops. So, most simplest and most simple and most cost effective. And when medicines don't work anymore, or the patient is not compliant, he's not able to use medicines properly and the glaucoma is progressing, or he's developing some allergy to the medications, then or in an end-stage disease, in a very advanced glaucoma, we advise surgery. Now, a lot of patients, they ask me, like, I'm tired, because sometimes we start with one drop, then over a period of time goes to two, then three, then four. And we have only four drops right now available in our armamentarium of glaucoma treatment. So after four medications, and it's very difficult to use these medications, you know, like morning, afternoon, night, and then tolerating the side effects of the drops. Each drop has its own side effect. And so when patients get tired of it, and most of the medications are quite expensive also. So many do go for surgery. They want to go for surgery, or the medical condition itself demands surgery. But a lot of people are also equally like, they're scared of going for any surgery, like a glaucoma surgery, because usually the myth is that glaucoma cannot be operated upon, which is totally wrong. Right now, the technology has vastly improved, and we have different types of glaucoma surgery available, not to only for the simple types, but also in complicated glaucomas. Very recently, like about 5 years back, a new technology called high-intensity focused ultrasound has been introduced for treatment of glaucoma. Now, this technology is not new because it was initially used for prostate cancer, but now its application in glaucoma is new. So what we are basically doing is, like, without touching the eyeball, we are focusing this ultrasound wave to ablate, means to dry up the ciliary processes, that is the organ inside the eye which produces the fluid. And this increase in the fluid pressure is glaucoma. So we are trying to basically reduce the pressure by reducing the fluid production. And this can be done totally from outside the eye without touching the eyeball, which reduces the risks of infections, surgical complications, anesthetic complications. The recovery period is very swift, like patients can go home immediately. They don't need to, you know, have any restrictions like head bath problems, and they can start their normal activities within 1 or 2 days. So it's a very interesting technology, and we are very excited to work on it. For the first time in Asia-Pacific region, we were the ones to introduce this treatment here, and we have got very exciting results. I have done around 115 patients, and it's very good.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Dr. Srilakshmi Garu, what is the solution if a patient has both glaucoma and cataract? In fact, Doctor, you can also give a...
We both take up combined surgery.
Yes.
So first I will remove the cataract, and Dr. Nilanjana will take over glaucoma. Yeah, honestly, it's, when there is a glaucoma associated, so technically glaucoma has to be handled along with the cataract, because as she already said, compliance of the patient. So sometimes the patients are on multi-drug, so if I remove the cataract, it's not that job is done. So there is that remaining part also has to be taken care. So sometimes we take a decision that we have to handle it on a single sitting, like after two procedures in at one sitting, like, so that has to be done that way. At times only a cataract surgery is done, and or else, you know, sometimes cataract, after the cataract surgery, some patients may develop glaucoma, then either the medication or some surgical procedure. Probably I think Nilanjana also will be able to answer this question.
See, basically when a patient
patient has both cataract and glaucoma, what I look at it in this way is like which is more damaging, whether the cataract is more severe or the glaucoma is more severe. Suppose the patient has very advanced cataract, but the glaucoma is not very bad. Then I would rather advise the patient to have the cataract surgery alone, because that leads to a quicker recovery and patient is very happy that he can see everything. So those cases we can manage by only a cataract surgery followed by drugs, because usually one drug should be enough in an early glaucoma. But if on the contrary the glaucoma is more severe and the cataract is mild, then we would prefer to have either a combined surgery or a glaucoma surgery first followed by a cataract surgery later, but clearly explaining to the patient that a glaucoma surgery does not lead to improvement in vision. It's only to prevent blindness. So once the patient understands and the work becomes much easier, control of the pressure is better.
Dr. Srilakshmi, if you could just give us a break of the cataract surgery cost, and is the entire surgery covered under insurance?
Yeah, most of the time it is covered. Some individual policies or corporate policies. There are many insurance companies have been offering, right? So, but these premium IOLs, some of the companies will not cover it. So, if the patient is interested, they can afford it, they have to top up that. Otherwise, most of the time it is being covered. Not the femtosecond laser, of course. It's a new technology. We have been looking forward to it. So,
what could be the approximate price, like just for?
May I answer this question?
Yes, sure.
The insurance reimbursement depends upon various factors. Number one, is it an individual insurance? Is it a corporate insurance? Is it an insurance done in this country? Is it an insurance somebody has it in US and then he or she gets it operated here? So clearly the, and also the amount of insurance that this person is carrying. Is it 10 lakhs? Is it 5 lakhs? Is it 2 lakhs? So depending on that, the insurance company will sanction a certain amount of money. There's also a stipulation with most companies that they don't cover the cataract surgery within the first 2 years of its detection, first 2 years of the insurance policy having been taken. That means you take the policy today and you want to get the cataract operated within 2 years, the companies may not cover. So I think your question, we cannot answer straight away that this much will be covered. That's difficult. So it all depends upon various factors.
Can you give us a brief of the approximate price, like femtosecond laser technology?
She's the one who does it.
See, usually,
like thousands or in lakhs, like just for the people to.
Yeah, it's only in thousands, extra, 40,000 extra for the ABCD packages. Extra we will be charging because the consumables are expensive in that procedure.
Dr. Jyotsna Garu, what is retinal detachment and causes for it?
Retina is a nerve tissue that is present in the back portion of the eye, and it can get detached in certain conditions, like as Dr. Satish sir was mentioning, those having near vision, near sightedness, like myopes. And especially it can occur after trauma, or detachment can sometimes occur in as a complication to uveitis, and these are the most common causes. And the symptoms can be, as sir was mentioning, the patient can persist symptoms as having floaters, sudden onset of floaters, or flashes of light, or a curtain like cloudiness in the field of vision, and it can be treated by surgery. It's an ophthalmic emergency, and it has to be treated diagnosed and addressed earliest.
I've heard something like a hole in the retina. Is it similar to that?
There are certain predisposing conditions in the retina called holes or lattices, and these are most commonly seen in people with nearsightedness, that is those having minus power glasses. So you strongly recommend any person who is myope to have at least once in a year retinal examination to see. It's not like the degree of myopia. A patient with simple -0.5 or -1.5 or -1 also can have retinal problems like holes or degenerations, and some of which need to be treated, and some of them which can be just absorbed. So yearly follow-up is a must for any short-sighted person.
Dr. Shubhra Garu, what is eyelid surgery and what can we expect from the procedure?
Okay. See, eyelid surgery is a very broad term which we are using here, but anything which we do on the eyelids, whether it's related to a defect which is present from birth, it is leading to some kind of cancerous growth, is it related to an injury around the eye, or is it cosmetic, right? So anything, any disorder which affects the shape, size, and the functionality of eyelid is what is eyelid surgery. So what you expect from it is depending upon what you have. For example, a patient has a mass or a bump over the eyelid. So you expect it that it has to be removed, right? Based on what kind of mass it is, the procedures are planned. For example, now the most common condition is the lower eyelid bags. So we do a surgery called blepharoplasty for it to remove it. Now, most of these procedures are ambulatory daycare procedures, and the recovery time is not more than a week. So a patient actually can think of having it as a lunch-on procedure where he comes and does. It is as convenient as having a cataract or a LASIK surgery nowadays. So it is that advanced, even in eyeplasty and cosmetic procedures.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Satish Garu, does cataract occur in children? If so, how is it treated?
Yeah, like I mentioned in my address, that the cataract can occur at any age group, starting from the newborn to early childhood or later in life, as I just talked about. The treatment for cataract, irrespective of whether it's occurring in a child or it's occurring in an adult, is surgery. There is no medical treatment that I just talked to you about. So once you see a cataract in a child, you have to operate. There are additional problems when one is operating on a child's eye. The various problems are, number one, if the child has a cataract in one eye, this becomes an additional problem in the sense that the eye which has a cataract also tends to become what is called as an amblyopic or a lazy eye, unless it is treated very early in the day. And even when it is treated very early in the day, there is a very high probability of this eye developing amblyopia or a lazy eye. So that is one problem. If it is, of course, a bilateral cataract, bilateral means both eyes are affected, then that problem is less likely to occur. Even there, it is important that you must operate both the eyes within a very short period. But if you leave the other eye surgery for a longer period, the same problem can occur. The third problem that occurs in children is the factor, how do you treat after the cataract is removed? Which means, do you give a contact lens, do you give a pair of glasses, or you put an intraocular lens? Earlier, it was, since the IOLs were not that great, most of the time it was the other two modalities. But now, since the IOLs have improved, we do put an IOL. But there again, there is a problem. That is, me as a person will not put an intraocular lens in a child who is less than 1 year. There are now people who are putting it in a child who is less than 1 year also, but again it has its own difficulties and problems. I don't want to go into the details of the surgical procedure, which also is specialized in a child's eye, but these are the various problems that one faces in a child's eye, but this treatment still is only one, and that is surgery.
Can children undergo LASIK?
No. Absolutely not. The LASIK procedure is done only at a time when the refraction or the refractive error stops progressing, and which usually occurs at the age of anywhere between 18 to 21. So to do a LASIK surgery before that, I think, is not a great idea.
Dr. Shubhra, can squint eye be treated, and what is the right age for treatment?
Okay, squint is mainly dealt with pediatric ophthalmologists, so we have specialists to do that. And yes, it can be treated. There are different causes of squint which are present. It could be from birth, it could be related to visual impairment, or it could be any other disorder inside the eye. So it's important to figure out why it is happening, and then the surgical treatment is one option. And second option is sometimes a simple thing like a high power in a child can cause squint, and so it can be treated with glasses. And what was the second part of the question?
What is the right age for treatment?
Yeah, I think the right age depends upon what is causing it. And I am not a specialist for that, but I think a pediatric ophthalmologist can do a proper screening and decision making and what can be done. If it is causing a visual impairment, which is causing, you know, problem in the development of a vision of a child, then it is done at an early stage. That's all I can say.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Jyotsna? What are the signs of macular degeneration? Can it be treated?
Macular degeneration, which was in few years back, which was very common in developed countries, has been increasingly becoming common in Indian continent, subcontinent as well, because of the change in the lifestyle habits as well as the changes in the dietary intake of the people. And the symptoms of the macular degeneration can are seen in individuals more than 60 years of age, and to begin with, and the types, it depends upon the symptoms depend on the type of the degeneration. And to simplify that, there are two types of degeneration. One is a dry type and the second one is a wet type. The individuals having the dry type of macular degeneration may not have symptoms in the early stage of the disease to begin with, whereas the patients presenting with the wet type of macular degeneration can have difficulties in the near vision to begin with, starting like they'll be seeing like waviness in the field of vision, or they may be having the difficulties in reading a text and missing letters, or some black spots in the field of vision, especially in the reading the near vision difficulties are the problems to begin with, and later on that will worsen to into proper darkish appearance in the field of vision in the advanced stages of the disease.
Thank you, Doctor. Any treatment available right now?
And as such, there is no treatment if the individual has a dry type of macular degeneration in advanced stages. But in case of wet type of macular degenerations, and we have the way of treatment, as such, there is no cure, but we can control the disease to some extent with intravitreal anti-VEGF injections. And also the special type of laser called PDT.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Shubhra Garu, one interesting question, like, are there surgeries available to reshape your eyes and make them more beautiful and appealing?
Of course. Not only surgery, even non-surgically. I mean, I can make your eyes beautiful right here. So there is a tip and trick for every disorder. That's the beauty of my specialty. But only thing I want to talk about with caution over here is a lot of these patients come to us with their idols in hands. For example, I want a Bipasha Basu look, or I want an Angelina Jolie look, or I want a particular eyelid. See, what genetically or by structure the God has or the nature has given, it can be changed or altered to a certain extent. That is the realistic picture. But yes, if you have something which is abnormal, as I said, if somebody has an eye which is slanting downwards or has a smaller eye, there are procedures to enhance them. Somebody has sunken eyes, there are procedures to enhance them. Somebody has eyes which are bulging out, we can do a lot of things about it. And as I said, it can be both surgical and non-surgical, which is individualized and tailor-made.
That's great. Dr. Satish Karu, what is a matured cataract? Are there any advanced surgery methods for matured cataract?
Word mature means when the cataract has become total. Days gone by, the stage at which the cataract will be operable was what we called as a mature cataract. So even today, there are a lot of people say, hey, that's a mature ho gaya ki nahi ho gaya. So that is meaningless in today's day and time. Today's day and age, the criterion for the surgery would be, I as a doctor will tell you, you have it or you don't have it. You don't have it, obviously no question of surgery. You have it, then I'll ask you, is it affecting your lifestyle? If the answer is yes, it is operable. Which means, and then the demand of each individual will be different as far as the vision is concerned. A chap who goes to the fields taking his buffaloes for grazing, his visual demands are definitely less compared to yours. So clearly you, as and when you develop a cataract, will need to get the surgery done at a much earlier stage than the person who is visual needs are much less. But no specialized, anything very specific about the mature cataract? No, it's the same surgical procedure.
Thank you, Dr. Shubhra.
Thank you, doctor, for the apt answer. Dr. Sri Lakshmi Garu, what are the advantages of multifocal IOL? Is this an option or compulsion in certain cases of cataract surgery?
Multifocal IOL is, in a name, as the name suggests, it does multitasking. Like, you know, you don't have to use glasses for your far vision or near vision. Nowadays, the intermediate distance for the computer. So this technology usually, you know, the, as you know, like the Shubhra's field of, you know, to look good, one aspect. And second aspect is, you don't like to wear use glasses for each and every task. So that's how this multifocal lens technology has been evolved. But then, if it is a compulsion, no, it is an option. Most of some people, basically, country like ours, most of them cannot afford. Because multifocal technology is more expensive than an usual routine IOL technology. So it need not be a compulsion. Like, you know, if you want to have a multifocal for your needs, you can opt for it. It's not that, you know, one should have a multifocal. Advantage is that you can get away from glasses.
Thank you, doctor. Okay, we are here to clear controversies also.
No, the only thing that I wanted to say was that sometimes in children's eyes, it may be a good idea, because if you put a unifocal lens, the child will still require a pair of glasses, and sometimes he or she may not wear it. So maybe a multifocal lens may be helpful in these children. So that's a sort of a, not really a compulsion, but a sort of a compulsion.
Thank you for these insights. Actually, it will be helpful for the viewers in future to take decisions. Now, this question I would like to ask our, I mean, entire panel, like with reference to a news article from India Today, I will read some experts in that. Among younger children, the burden of amblyopia and strabismus was 84.4% and 26.6% respectively. Among the referred patients, strabismus was noted in 84.6%. The article points out that there is a growing number of cases of squint in children. Can you please explain the reasons for it and how should people overcome it? You can give your views on it.
I think the part of the question was already answered when you asked me the squint question. But I think we should not strictly go by these data, statistical data. But yes, to point out why is it increasing is, I think the awareness has increased. I mean, it's not that the squint was not existing 15 years ago. We did have squinting of eyes, we did have diabetic retinopathy. People are getting more and more aware, so the data is coming out more. That's point number one. And point number two is that with the changing lifestyles, we have certain diseases or disorders which are changing. I mean, for example, as I mentioned, squinting of eye could be just a simple refractive error in the eye, which goes undiagnosed, you know. Or there could be something happening which is related to the development of the eye, which is leading to it. So I don't think the incidence has increased because the disease process has increased. I think the incidence has increased because the reporting of the disease is much more, awareness is much better. That's how I would like to put it. But anybody from the panel?
I agree with you.
Could you just give us a brief description about the amblyopia and strabismus? Like, curiosity.
I mean, strabismus is the technical term for squint.
Okay,
so it's very simple. You call it squint or strabismus.
Okay.
Amblyopia, as we were discussing, it's a lazy eye. So it's the eye which is not seeing what it is supposed to see. There's a suppression of the visual centers and the way the whole visual pathway is related to the brain. So it's kind of suppressing it. Again, there could be reasons which starts from your cornea, which is the black portion of eye, to the optic nerve. It could be anything causing it.
Thank you, doctor. Dr. Jyotsna, does diabetic retinopathy occur in women when they are pregnant? Does it have an effect on the child in the womb?
Diabetic retinopathy does occur in women with gestational diabetes or women who are already been diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. And retinopathy is likely to worsen, especially if the pregnant lady doesn't maintain the sugar levels according to the physician guidelines, and so they need a screening of the retina every month, and had to be treated if possible medically, because surgery may not be possible all the times, And the child, even if the mother undergoes treatment, the child may not be affected. But the thing is, over a period of time, the child has also the risk of developing diabetes after 8 to 10 years of age.
What is happening inside the eyes for the people with glaucoma?
It's basically like simple example, like a tire which has air inside. So if you pump in more air to it, so it gets swollen up and it's a very high pressure. So just imagine any soft point inside the tire that would get compressed. So that's the optic nerve. So when the pressure inside the eye increases due to an imbalance between the production and the outflow of the fluid, the optic nerve is the most delicate part in the eyeball, which is very susceptible to this raised pressure. So this starts like ballooning out, and you know, if we call it cupping, like it gets damaged. So that's basically the mechanism in the most common types of glaucoma. And in some special cases where we call it a normal tension glaucoma, where the pressure is normal, but still you have glaucoma, the mechanism is more related to the blood vessels. So the nutrition of the optic nerve is decompensated due to an imbalance in the blood circulation. So this can happen in patients with diabetes, with arthritis, with other vascular disorders. People who snore in the night, there is a sleep apnea problem, they are more likely to have this kind of normal tension glaucoma.
So good to know, like, people who are snoring also are prone to glaucoma. So just be aware and get yourself checked. My next question to Dr. Shubhra. Actually, my next question is also already answered by Nilanjana Galu, that without pressure also glaucoma can be, is possible. So I'm skipping that. Can cosmetic filler injections have any effect on vision?
See, the complications related to the cosmetic dermal fillers is very, very rare. Okay, though there are scattered reports which says that the patient had a loss of vision, I think it's very important for anybody who comes, you know, nowadays Google is half knowledge, right? But a lot of people would fish out some articles and say, oh, this has a complication, that has a complication. See, no procedure or no surgery is without any sequelae or complications. It is always a risk, but that doesn't mean that the procedure has complications, right? So the visual impairment or the visual loss related to cosmetic dermal fillers have been reported, but this happens only if the person who's injecting is not aware of the anatomy, is not injecting the right amount, and is injecting in the wrong places. So these are the only places where, and more than the under eye fillers, it is the filler which is given in the center between the brow area which causes the blindness. So the maximum reports of visual impairment with cosmetic fillers is not under eyes, but between this area, we call it as a glabella. So it is a little bit of misunderstanding, because that's how the information has been put up in the public forum.
Thank you so much. Good to know. Dr. Satish Karu, can we, if you have cataract, can one undergo LASIK surgery for nearsightedness?
It sort of doesn't make sense, because if you have a cataract, I can put an intraocular lens and that will take care of that error that he or she has. So no, the answer is no, it doesn't make sense at all.
Thank you, doctor. And what is the right age for LASIK surgery?
As I said, once the myopia or the hypermetropia, whatever the error is, starts to become stationary, not progressing, usually around 18, 19, 20, around that age.
Thank you, doctor. Dr. Sri Lakshmi Garu, what is bladeless LASIK? What are the advantages of bladeless LASIK to the patient?
Yeah, to understand that LASIK has around 30 microns, something like that. We make a flap first, we lift it up, and then put the laser underneath. So this flap making, usually it's been done using a blade so far. Blade means not a big blade, it's also a microscopic thing. But then this is also a very good procedure, but there are certain corneas are not good for this blade flap. It can give rise to complications. So that's how a blade-free LASIK has been evolved. So this blade-free can be done on any kind of corneas. but there are certain prerequisites, whether it is blade or blade free. A screening has to be done, whether LASI can be done or not. So blade free, that's how it is much more safer than blade LASI. And also the precision, because it's a laser, right? So suppose if I want to lift a flap of 100 microns, and it's only a 3-4 microns this side or that side, I'm pretty sure that I'm making that much of thickness of flap. Whereas blade is some kind of an erratic kind of thing. It can make a much thicker flaps or a much thinner flaps. So in certain corneas, it can be very risky kind of thing. So that's how the safety factor is much more higher in blade-free LASIK.
So do we still need reading glasses after LASIK surgery?
The procedures are done on farsightedness or nearsightedness. Usually you see in youngsters, right? So this, as sir rightly said, you know, the power has to be stable before you undertake this procedure. Usually the dictum is by 18 or 20, these powers will get the stability. Then, you know, this is something like an anatomical kind of problem, like genetic problem. But then not all of us will have glasses, right? So, but after 40, all of us will have a phenomena called accommodation. This will get weaker, so we can't focus near. So we have to use glasses for reading. So suppose a 20 plus person getting a LASIK done, at the age of 40 plus, that person will have reading glasses. So person of 50 age, if they come for a procedure, we will explain them that we can only take care of the power for the distance, but not for the near.
Thank you so much, doctor. Dr. Satish Karu, could you please explain us what is dry eyes, and is LASIK surgery done for people with dry eyes?
The dry eye basically is the two types of tears that are produced in the eye. One is what is called the basal secretion, which me and you are having at the moment. The other is a reflex secretion, which you have when you were laughing very loudly yesterday when I saw you, or the crying that you were doing day before yesterday. So that is a reflex secretion. So once the basal secretion goes down, that could be because of many reasons without going into that, then that is what is called as a dry eye. And you have to replace that tear fluid with an artificial tear. Now, to answer the question whether you can do the LASIK in a situation like this, I think you should not do a LASIK in this situation, because the LASIK itself produces a dry eye. So eye which is dry, and you do a LASIK on that, you're making it doubly dry, and you patient is going to be troubled, and he or she is going to trouble me too. So I won't. No.
So who are more susceptible to this dry eye condition? I think the software.
Well, that's one of those rare things where the females are more susceptible. More often than not, people like me who are more susceptible to anything except this one situation.
Thank you, doctor. Dr. Shubhra Garu, what is Botox for eyes especially? Is it safe, and how long does the results last?
Okay, Botox is a drug called botulinum toxin. Okay, it was basically invented initially or used basically for, you know, the spasms or the twitching around the eyes and the squinting of the eyes which we were discussing. But down the line, we found that when we were injecting in these patients, even the wrinkles faded away. So botulinum toxin is used in the whole body for different indications which are functional. Around the eyes, the indication is cosmetic and functional. When I say cosmetic, it's the smile lines. You know, you must have read about all the celebrities and the pastry personalities, and even common man like us getting it done. And the functional indications are the spasms or the twitchings which happen around the eye. When we see a lot of patients having repeated blinking. The blinking which is happening because of dryness of eyes or any other disorder is not what I'm talking about, but the problem where the patient or the person does not have a control on the twitching which is happening. So these are the main areas where botulinum toxin is used. And again, coming to your question which you asked me for cosmetic dermal fillers, Botox is absolutely safe. There are some consequences which can happen if the drug itself is not given in proper dosages, again injected in a wrong plane. So again, I emphasize this, that, you know, you must have seen a lot of these Botox fillers clinics mushrooming in the city or in our country. It is very, very important for an individual to understand who is injecting these things. Because if the person does not know the anatomy and the physiology, just taking a syringe and injecting is very easy when you can do it. But what results are you going to give to your patient is very important. And you asked me about the longevity of this is usually on an average 3 to 4 months. So every 3 to 4 months, the person has to come back.
That's great. So will that be right to say that Botox was discovered by an ophthalmologist?
Yes. It wasn't discovered by an ophthalmologist, but it was in the ophthalmology indication side, it was Dr. Scott was the one who was used mainly for the squinting of the eye initially. And then it got an FDA approval for cosmetic uses.
So this is a really good to know information. Dr. Nilanjana Garu, what condition determines surgery for glaucoma?
So as I already mentioned that patients who are advancing beyond the maximal medications, that we have given him 4 drops, still the glaucoma is progressing, he's losing sight. And or patients who are developing allergy to the medication, some side effects, patients who cannot use the medicine properly, like they're forgetting or they're not able to afford the drug, and it is a sight threatening condition, those patients we usually recommend surgery.
Thank you, doctor. Dr. Shubhra, once again, what are the causes for puffy eyes and dark circles?
$1 million question. Okay, I think everybody you know, who will be listening to this would have a puffy eye or a dark circle. All of us sitting here have puffy and dark circles. So it's a very, very common disorder. Now, puffy eyes is what you see, the bulge below the eyes. It could be because of water collection and fat collection. So the water collection can happen in diseases like thyroid or hypertension or diabetes, and to some extent people who have renal disorders. Okay. And the fat which comes out could be secondary to this or an age-related issue. So this is puffiness. Dark circles is a very, very complex entity. It is not just darkness of eyes. It is just not darkness under the eyes. And a lot of people come and say, doctor, I have not slept, so I've got dark circles. It's not like that. The dark circles get enhanced if you don't sleep well. Dark circles are present in you under your eyes because of 3 factors, which is your skin, your bony structure, and the way the light is reflected around the eyes. So that's why you see all the makeup and everything hides the dark circles, right? So this is what dark circles and puffiness is all about. The treatment modalities, again, based on an individual, what is causing it, why is it happening, and what can give the best results could be surgical or non-surgical. Surgical mainly is in the form of blepharoplasty is what we do, or you know, the redistribution of fat under the eyes. And non-surgical are the combination of Botox and dermal fillers with some cosmeceutical creams. So that is what it is.
Does puffy eyes indicate any medical problem, as you've already mentioned?
Yeah, that's what I mentioned, yeah.
So, Dr. Satish Garu, how long does LASIK surgery last?
Means the procedure, how long does it take?
No, is it permanent? Is the procedure permanent?
Yes, it is permanent, but sometimes some changes can occur over a period of time. But normally, yes, the answer is yes.
Thank you, doctor. Dr. Jyotsna Garu, can uveitis be treated with alternative medicines like Ayurvedic?
I don't have knowledge. I cannot comment on this. I'm not aware of this other than allopathy treatments for any retinal or uveitis pathologies.
Brief us about what exactly is uveitis.
Uveitis is a broad spectrum, just like glaucoma, and again depends upon the, I mean, whether it is anteriorly located or whether it is located behind the eye or it is present in between anterior and posterior chambers. And there are most of the times the cause of the uveitis is not known, and many a times, and especially it's a very broad spectrum, and the causes could be different for the different age groups. If it is a child having the uveitis, we have to check for the any orthopedic problems associated with the kids, which are most commonly they present as uveitis, rheumatology diseases in the kids. And if it is a middle-aged population, the causes could be mainly infections like in especially Indian scenario, like tuberculosis and sarcoid, and things should be ruled out. And if it is again the advanced stages of also that again the tuberculosis could be one of the reasons, or and sometimes tumors can also present as uveitis, and sometimes any surgical interventions also can result in uveitis. And all most of the times the diagnosis is clinical, and with the help of other diagnostic modalities we can make a proper come to a proper conclusion.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Nilanjana Garu, why does the doctor want to do more than one kind of glaucoma test? Can you please brief us about the tests available?
Tests are of two types. Like we have some examinations and we have the investigations. So examinations include like measuring the eye pressure by techniques like a non-contact tonometry, which is mostly a screening technique available in most of the eye hospitals these days. And a simple technician can also do it. So you don't need the doctor to do a non-contact tonometry. But it's a very useful technique because you have an estimate of the eye pressure. Second thing is like the glaucoma specialist usually uses a particular machine called the affination tonometer, where he or she touches the eye and checks the pressure inside the eye directly. So that is the more accurate method of estimating the eye pressure. Then we have a test called gonioscopy, where you put a lens on the cornea, that is the black part of the eye, and you check the drainage passage, whether the passage is open or closed, and whether there are any other factors causing glaucoma, like presence of new blood vessels and or oil in which we use in retinal attachment surgeries. And then the third test, what we do is like checking the optic disc condition inside the eye by using special lenses on the slit lamp. So by these three things, basically, you have an idea whether the patient is likely to have glaucoma or not. So only after these three things are done in the office, then only we have a suspicion, and then we advise some special tests, which include first and foremost the visual field evaluation. Because in glaucoma, as I said already, that the sight vision is what is affected in the initial part. So we check the sight vision by a visual field test called, this test is called perimetry. And next thing is tachymetry, the central corneal thickness. The corneal thickness is very important because people with thinner corneas, the pressure in the office may seem to be less, but is usually the pressure is actually high inside. And if the pressure in the cornea is thick, then there may be overestimation. And you may assume it's glaucoma and unnecessarily give medications to the patient thinking it is glaucoma. So that's why the corneal thickness is very important. And lastly, we have a new, not new, but more recently, it has become very popular among glaucoma specialists, is the OCT, that is the optical coherence tomography, which picks up this nerve fiber layer damages and the ganglion cell damages. These are very early changes in glaucoma, and very sensitive method to detect early glaucoma and prevent further damage. Because it's very important to understand that a perimetry can pick up a defect usually after 30 or 40% of nerve has already been damaged. So in that window period, it is the OCT which picks up the defects. So these are basically the three things we use very often in the glaucoma clinic.
Thank you, doctor. Last three questions. Dr. Shubhra Garu, who are the ideal candidates for lower eyelid injections for under eye rejuvenation?
Okay, as I said, the cosmetic dermal fillers, as you're talking about, right? So these are used for the patients who have hollowness under the eyes, dark circles, a lot of skin laxity, or very early bags. In young individuals, we usually don't recommend surgeries. So to camouflage those bags, these are the injections which are done. In addition, now we have also started using these injections for functional disorders. Like for example, there's an interning of the eyelid in a child where we cannot operate. So we can actually put these injections to outturn the eye. So there's a lot of innovation going around with these injections. which is both for function and cosmetic.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Satish Karu, one last question for you. What is corneal abrasion and what are the treatments for it?
Cornea has five layers. The most superficial layers is called as the epithelium. Epithelium gets abraded or denuded by any reason, that is called as a corneal abrasion. This could happen with as simple a thing as you putting a kajal in your eye, with your finger and your nail can cause the corneal abrasion, and any other small foreign body, small injury with a leaf or whatever. And the simple treatment quite often is to do nothing except to put some either tear drops or antibiotic drops. But if it is a large one and it gives rise to a severe pain, by the way, then in those cases you may have to just close the eye. 24 hours closing the eye may be sufficient. Once in a while it is not, and then you may have to treat it by giving what is called as a contact lens. Contact lens is temporary. It is only for this. It's not for vision. So that will be.
One last question for you, Dr. Sri Lakshmi. Can people undergo LASIK if they already have keratoconus? If you can just give...
No way.
Okay.
It's an absolute contraindication.
Okay.
The risk of LASIK is itself is keratoconus, like we might induce keratoconus. To understand what is keratoconus is, the thinning of the cornea, and it is an irregular cornea. So even normal glasses cannot give the good vision, corrected vision. So especially designed contact lenses are available. Other various procedures to treat today, we have fortunately a procedure called C3 radiation is available, so that you can postpone the surgery of corneal transplant. It will end up in a corneal transplant. So LASIK, the main complication, the serious complication would be keratoconus. So you cannot do LASIK on a keratoconus.
Thank you, Doctor. Now, in the market nowadays, we have some eye-protecting glasses available, especially for the software individuals and multimedia professionals. So are they really genuine? Do they really work? And can they be used without a prescription?
Yeah.
I think you people are the best people.
I don't believe in that. No. It's a trade secret. Most of the optical outlets, they say it as anti-glare and something like that. They tell these people, and that's how people will end up buying all those things. But I personally do not recommend such kind of things.
Do they really work?
It's more than these protective or the anti-glare what doctor is mentioning. I think what is important to have the blue light protection glasses. And those glasses are expensive. They are available, whether it's there in Indian market, I don't know. And more than that, I think what is more important when we are talking about the protection of eyes from gadgets is the way they are used, the ergonomics in the room where you're working, and changing your lifestyle. Because we are very, very commonly seeing nowadays the computer vision syndrome, which can cause simple things like excessive watering and irritation to heaviness of eyelids and a lot of swellings and bumps around the eyes. So I think it's an amalgamation of everything which a person should be looking at, but no shortcuts, like just wearing an anti-reflective would solve all the problems.
So I think we all must take a note of this.
See, these kind of glasses should be bought from opticals who are quite reputed, and because sometimes what happens in those cheaper brands who look good, the function may not be really good because it should be totally either it should be a plano power. Sometimes while molding these glasses, we introduce some power in it. So that can lead to eye strain and fatigue. And the material also, they say it's 100% UV protection. So it has to be really genuine 100% UV protection or not, that has to be verified.
So Facebook followers, one question is from Mr. Mayang Gera from IIM Ahmedabad, age 34. His vision in the eye is 6x9 and it is not correctable to glasses to 6x6. Can it be corrected by LASIK? If so, suggest the right procedure.
What spectacles cannot correct, no procedure can correct that. So if his vision is 6x9, means his vision will be 6x9 by any means.
Another question from Mr. Ravi Alaf, age 35.
Can LASIK be performed on -1.5 by -1.5 without any issues in further? He has a doubt that he read in some article that the power has to go beyond certain value to have a surgical, successful surgery. So what is the right age and right power to undergo LASIK?
Whether it is 1.5 or -15 or whatever, if you don't want to wear glasses, is there another substitute, like you don't use glasses or contact lenses? It's not the power, it is your suitability. People having higher power also may be suitable. Some people having even -1 also may not be suitable. That screening is important before you go for procedure.
Thank you for the answer. And one last question. Question again from Mr. Uday. I had a glue surgery for pterygium 2 years back. Is that the right? Pterygium. Okay. Pterygium 2 years back. Can I proceed for LASIK treatment now?
Certainly. Again, I said that screening is important.
Okay. Thank you. And I think one more question. This question is from Soumya from Hyderabad. Her age is 26. Her question is that her retinal thickness is less than 500 microns. Earlier, doctor suggested...
Corneal thickness.
I'm so sorry. Okay, corneal thickness. Fine. Is less than 500 microns. Earlier, doctor suggested as not to go for LASIK. Is there any procedure which can help to remove my glasses?
Yeah, depending on the power, there is another option, having a permanent lens inside. ICL it is known as. This is also a very good procedure. It gives very high definition vision. If you are not suitable, LASIK or PRK.
Thank you so much. I think the viewers, most of your questions have already been answered. And for any further queries, you can always log on to Hi9. And now I would request our viewers, if you have any questions, you can pose them to our doctors here.
Good evening, sir. నా పేరు చెన్నకేశ్వ, హైదరాబాద్లో ఉంటాను. నాకు చిన్న స్మాల్ డౌట్. యాక్చువల్గా 12-14 ఇయర్స్ పీపుల్, చిన్నపిల్లలు ఉంటారు కదా, వాళ్ళు నైట్ పడుకున్న తర్వాత మార్నింగ్ లేచిన తర్వాత కళ్ళకి పూసి అనేది పడుతుంది కదండి, అది అంటే ఎందుకు వస్తుంది? అది ఏమైనా ఎక్కువైతే ఏమైనా ప్రాబ్లమ్స్? కళ్ళు మూసుకోపోతే జనరల్గా అదొక
అది రెగ్యులర్గా అంటే చాలా ఎక్కువ ఉంటే ఏదైనా ఇన్ఫెక్షన్ ఉందని అర్థము. నార్మల్గా మనందరికీ వస్తుంది కాబట్టి అది ప్రాబ్లం కాదు. ఎక్కువగా వస్తుంది అంటే ఏమైనా ఇన్ఫెక్షన్ ఉందా అనేది మనం ఎగ్జామినేషన్ చేయించుకోవాలి.
అంటే వాళ్ళకి నైట్ అంటే ఏమైనా రియాక్షన్ జరిగి అలా అవుతుందా?
నో, మనందరికీ
అందరికీ రాదు కదా జనరల్గా.
చాలా వరకు వస్తుంది, అది ఎక్కువగా వచ్చినప్పుడు ప్రాబ్లం.
ఓకే, దానికి అంటే మెడిసిన్స్ ఏమైనా తీసుకొని
అది ఏంటనేది చూడాలి. ఒట్టి ఇన్ఫెక్షనా, లేకపోతే ఒక్కొక్కసారి కొంతమందికి ఇక్కడ లోపల బ్లాక్ ఉంటుంది, ఆ బ్లాక్ ఉంటే కూడా వాటరింగ్ ప్లస్ అలా డిశ్చార్జ్ ఎక్కువ అంటుకుపోవడం ఉంటుంది. సో ఆ బ్లాక్ ఉందా లేదా కూడా ఎగ్జామినేషన్ చేయించాలి.
అంటే ఓన్లీ చిన్నపిల్లలకే వస్తుంది? అందుకని
చిన్నపిల్లలకని అంటే మీరు ఏజ్ చెప్పలేదు, కానీ కొంతమందికి పుట్టంగానే కూడా అది ఒక అది బ్లాక్ అయి ఉంటుంది. అది వాళ్ళ పిల్లలకి 18 అంటే 18 మంత్స్ వచ్చే వరకు వెయిట్ చేస్తాము, మసాజింగ్ అని చెప్తాం, మదర్స్ చేయాలి అది. ఒకవేళ అది ఓపెన్ కాకపోతే 18 మంత్స్ తర్వాత 2 ఇయర్స్ అప్పుడు మేము చేయాల్సి వస్తుంది అన్నమాట. చిన్నపిల్లలు అంటే అదేనా మీరు ఏజ్ గ్రూప్ అడిగింది?
12-14 ఇయర్స్
అంటే మళ్ళీ ఇదే
ఇలాంటిది లేచినప్పుడు
అలా ఏమి ఉండదు. 12-14 ఇయర్స్
వస్తుంది,
అది రెగ్యులర్ ప్రాబ్లం ఏం కాదు. అప్పుడప్పుడు వస్తే ఇగ్నోర్ చేయొచ్చు, అదేం ప్రాబ్లం.
ఓకే, థ్యాంక్ యూ.
Common thing nowadays what we observe, or now people are going for LASIK surgery, is there something like eye exercises we can do so as to avoid spectacles or LASIK surgery?
I'm usually not politically correct, so therefore my answer is no, there's absolutely no eye exercise which can take care of your need of glasses or LASIK.
No, what I'm actually asking is there no alternative, like pathologically something happens inside our body, and there's something like immune system which generally corrects it. Is there nothing like that with respect to eyes?
A pair of contact lens or undergoing a kind of a refractive surgery.
Thank you, sir. I got one more question. Actually, recently I watched this video on Facebook where they've operated the eye. He has made some kind of a slit inside the eye and has removed some 50 centimeter long white worm what has caused that? I mean, can't we identify it before it has grown that long? What are the general reasons for that?
No, that's a very interesting question. But yeah, we cannot diagnose it because, you know, we still don't know how it enters. Okay, so, but the person or the patient would present with some irritation or something happening. Sometimes it's not even known to the patient. Once we're doing a general examination, we see something abnormal moving and we take it out. So yeah, the answer to this question is little unanswered for you.
Thank you,
sir. అలాగే యూజ్ చేయడానికి ఏమైనా లెన్సెస్ ఉన్నాయా? మనం ఫ్రీగా ఐ లోపల పెట్టుకొని లెన్సెస్ యూజ్ చేసుకొని వర్క్ చేసుకోవడానికి
విజన్ శుభ్రంగా ఉంటే ఏ విధమైన కళ్ళ జోళ్ళు ఏం అవసరం లేదు.
అంటే 3D రెండర్ చేసుకోవడానికి 3D కాంటాక్ట్
ఎలాగో 3D వేస్తున్నారు కదా, మీ విజన్ బాగుంది,
ఎక్కువ వస్తుంది కదండి.
అవును, మరి ఎక్కువ అది 3D మీద చూసినప్పుడు కాన్స్టాంట్గా చూస్తే వస్తుంది. సో మధ్య మధ్యలో బ్రేక్ ఇవ్వడమే, దానికి స్పెషల్గా లోపల పెట్టేమే ఉండవు.
థ్యాంక్ యూ అండి.
Thank you all for your questions. Hi Night Talks. Dr. Nilanjana.
This was the first experience for me and it was very interesting. And I think it's a good platform to interact with the public and, you know, some simple tips about eye health and the often we have doubts and we don't know whom to ask, where to ask. And it's not a disease that we need to visit an ophthalmologist for that. So it's a very good platform for interaction.
As one of the US said, it may be silly question, but silly questions are, you know, the platform to address all these their silly doubts or whatever. And it's a very, very interesting thing that it was my first experience here. I really enjoyed it.
Dr. Satish Garu.
To me, what I found interesting was that you had some questions which will be there in the minds of a lot of people, which were. Some of them we answered very well, the others we were not able to answer as well. And one of the things that I noticed particularly in this country, and it is becoming common in the rest of the world also, is this question of alternative medicine for various conditions. And you did ask those questions to many of us. Some of us were very direct, some of us were not. But I do want to emphasize on one or two simple things in this, and that is that alternative medicine has its own role. But one should be aware that where it has a role and where it doesn't have a role. I think a lot of us actually are getting mistreated or maltreated by resorting to alternative medicine. Like, for example, one of the questions you asked was whether the uveitis can be treated by Ayurveda. She was very politically correct. So she dodged the question, or she not. I wouldn't use the word dodge, but she said I won't answer it. But I would like to answer that question. I'll say there is no Ayurveda treatment for the uveitis, as far as I know. So I think it is important for people to understand that medicine is medicine, whether you take Ayurvedic medicine or you take allopathic medicine. After all, you are taking medicine, so why should you go to a medicine which is not really fully scientifically explained? So that's one point that I wanted to emphasize in all this talk that we have had. And I think it's a very interesting platform. It will be probably be more interesting if there were many more questions from the people either here or online that you got the questions from.
Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Shibra Garu.
Yeah, first of all, thank you for having me here. And I think it's a great platform to create an awareness. I think what everybody is missing is, as I mentioned, there are shortcuts available on so-called Google searches where somebody would type a word and have a thesis written and come to walk into our clinic saying that I have this problem. So before we diagnose, the patients have the diagnosis in hand that I have so and so. But they don't understand that this is just a half knowledge. I think the awareness about each and every disease process, the treatment, as we have had the discussion today, is really necessary to open up the eyes of, you know, the patient. Nowadays, we don't even call them patients, we call them as clients. It's very important because there is competition, there is advancement of science every single day. So unless you're aware of what's available, you cannot pick up the best for yourself. I think that is what I would like to say.
Thank you, Doctor. And how did you like the show?
How did you like the show?
Oh, it was wonderful. I mean, I'm glad you asked so many questions on cosmetic
Thank
in
you.
Oncliffe last year. I think that was really needed.
Thank you. Dr. Jia Jostangaru.
Yeah, I would like to congratulate Hi9 TV and all the team members, especially Shivagaru and you. And you have got done a very good effort in bringing out, pulling out all the questions. More importantly, I'm surprised to people having no knowledge on the medical field, asking so relevant questions and asking to a particular doctor. And then it will be very useful to the common audience as well. And in continuation with Dr. Satish sir, I'd also like to stress upon that there are some centers in Hyderabad which are claiming malpractices, like they are going to treat diseases like night blindness and vision loss due to advanced stages of diabetic retinopathy. And I've seen many educated patients as well going to those centers and spending thousands of rupees on that. And at the end of the day, they're coming out, result is that they're becoming blind. So you Hi9 people like you and as well as other channels should look upon into this seriously and bring into the notice of the public, so that in this era of modernization, people are still believing in those malpractices and wrong medical treatments and going by their advertisements and all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, doctor, for this piece of advice. And we are so fortunate to have you all around and educating us. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Shivagaru onto the stage once again and felicitate all our panel members. We would like to felicitate Dr. Satish Garu first. Let us all bring our hands together to give them a huge roar of applause. I will request Dr. Shivagaru to felicitate Dr. Sri Lakshmi Nimmagada Garu. So I'll yeah, Dr. Sri Lakshmi. And Dr. Nilanjana Dev Garu. Thank you, Doctor, for being here and giving your precious time to us, in fact, all of you. Next, I would like to request Dr. Shivagaru to felicitate Dr. Shubhra Garu. Thank you, Shubhra Garu, for such a beautiful information that you've given us. Thank you. And finally, Dr. Jyotsna Garu. Thank you, Doctor, for being with us, spending your time here and educating all of us. Thank you once again, all the doctors. Now, I can see here everybody is committed for making this event so successful. Hi9 takes immense pleasure to thank everyone who has given their support and spent their valuable time with us. I would also like to thank the doctors, audience, visitors, and the speakers, the organizing team, and all those who were behind the screen and have helped this event to be a great success. We have a huge number of viewers also, online viewers, almost 50,000. I don't know the count, but that's what our statistics tells. And Hi9 looks forward for many such events in future. Let's join our hands to build a healthy India and healthy future generation. Thank you once again. Thank you, doctors, and thank you, audience. Thank you.